Hello friends, you're with the Lonesome Gamer, and today I'm going to play Alexander the Great by Richard Burke. And similar to our last experience, Rise of the Roman Republic, this is also part of a planned project, and it's the first part, The Conquerors, and it is also the last part. And well, as I said, very similar to Rise of the Roman Republic, which ended after two games. Carthage was the second one, and then they stopped this ancient world project. Here, after the first game, they cancelled their plans to continue this. And honestly, already before I start this, I'm kind of skeptical about it. When I played that, I kind of played it just halfway through. But it was so terribly unbalanced. Alexander was so superior, and the Persians just, they lost one battle after another. It was a quite frustrating experience, and also a pretty boring one. Still, I want to do that simply because it's the only game on a strategic scale about this very important time in history and campaign, and that I have. I know there is also Field Commander Alexander, which is pretty popular, but I'm not sure if I like these, if I like that pure solo style game. So I want to do that, and maybe we'll have a positive surprise here. Okay, so the game is set, and let me give you a quick look at the map. It's a point-to-point movement system. Not too many surprises. We got these minor cities or standard spaces, the round ones. We got these hexagons. These are major cities. And if there's an enemy inside, they have to be besieged. And we have these hexagons with a white border. And these are treasure cities. And they are important for supply and also for the raising of armies. We have also some transit points, these red ones here. It's important to notice that troops are not allowed to end their movement on such a transit point. We have these mountains and mountain passes. They cost a little more movement points to cross. Here we have also some naval routes and some deep sea routes. So no big surprises here. And down here we have desert and one strait right here. Okay. In addition, we have some cards, markers. These are garrison markers. These are the Macedonians, the red ones. The blue ones are the Persians. We have these number counters, which are very important. And few other markers here. Now, This part here indicates the strength of the different armies. Each player can have up to 3 armies. And army number 1 is always led by the overall commander, Alexander III on the Macedonian side, and Darius on the Persian side. The first army has always to be the biggest army. That's an important rule. If that's not the case, you have to refill it. So we have Alexander with 33 strength army. It's a very abstract system. There are no infantry units or cav or something. It's just army strength points, ASP 33. And he starts here at Perintos with army number 1. Okay. Then we have Antipater over there at Pella, and he starts with 15 ASP. In addition, we have somewhere else here Hegelochos with the Macedonian fleet with a naval strength point value of 3. We see Darius back home in Susa, and there he is. He's with his family, the royal family, and the royal treasury, which is empty at the moment. And he starts with 42 strength points. Then we have here Memnon near Alexander's army at Cyzicus with 40 strength points. And these fleets here are under Persian control. The Ionian fleet, the fleet of Tyre, and the Egyptian fleet. And there we have the admiral Pharnabazus. In addition, we were allowed to deploy some garrisons. These are the ones of the Macedonians. They can be only deployed in Europe. And we can see here lots of them in Asia Minor on the Persian side, and then some in the treasure cities here in Memphis and in Damascus. We'll see if that helps. I forgot to mention that we have here the activation markers, the chit pull system in that cup. Here we have leaders, Persian leaders and Macedonian leaders, and a few not too beautiful dice. Now, interesting to see that the ASP availability of the Macedonians is only 75. So that is the maximum of troops they can raise. And there is no way they get additional ones. So if they raised all these 75 troops, then, yeah, that's their limit. They have to deal with it then. The Persians have a lot more troops available. They have 175 available. But the problem is that their troops are much weaker. And that shows in the elite level, which we have here. Now the first army, army number one, has an elite level of 4, and the second army an elite level of 2. Both Persian armies only have an elite level of 1. That should represent the superior weaponry of the Macedonians. And that is a big factor in the game. Apart from that, we have a track here, the Macedonian army weariness. It's kind of the war weariness. So if they're not willing to fight anymore, we see rebellions going on. And I think there can be, this is one of the ways how the Persians can win. If the war weariness is at 20, there is a chance that the army simply falls apart. And then the Persians win the game. Another option is that Alexander dies, and we see here the Alexander injury level. If that is a 20, we also have to roll dice, and then it can happen that he dies. That's also a way for the Persians to win. These are basically the main options. So we must see one thing in the game, and that makes it hard for me to enjoy, actually. A military victory is completely impossible. The Persians will get beaten up in the worst way. There is absolutely no chance for them to have a real success on a military way against Alexander. He is so superior. First of all, he has these elite status on his army. And second of all, he is a very good leader with a battle rating of 4. And that is also an important factor during battle. Less important are the numbers of troops. So, actually, you could say if you lose a battle and you have the higher value or the higher numbers of troops, you often also lose more troops. And therefore, Alexander is in the position that he usually will win the battles with less troops, and therefore his losses will also be less. So let's see what Alexander wants to do. He can win the game in the following way. He has to do a lot of things. He has to become great king. That's the first part. So to do that, he has to control the provinces of Lydia, Babylonia, Media, Susiana, and Persis. Okay, these are the provinces which are with have a red letters here. Lydia. Phrygia? Is that red? Seems so. Mesopotamia, Babylonia, Media, Susiana, and Persis is down here. I'm not sure if this is actually red. I don't think it is. Mesopotamia? No. It's not Phrygia. He doesn't need Phrygia. He only needs Lydia, which is here. Okay. So, then he wants to capture or kill Darius III. Then he wants to become king of Asia. If he does that by having Alexander end an action round in Gordium, which is here. There he can cut the Gordian knot and in this way become king of Phrygia. of Asia. In addition, he needs to gain control of the royal family and marry a Persian princess. Okay, these guys are here. Now that makes him king of Asia, but that's not all. He has to maintain the hegemony of Greece, so he must control all European provinces, none of which may be in revolt. The European provinces are the one with a green border, so not Thrace and not Thessaly. But Crete. And finally, he has to establish his deity. So he wants to control Egypt. He wants to build Alexandria in Egypt, so which is here. Right now it's not existing yet. He wants to end an action in Ziva. His visit to the Oracle of Amun at the Ziva Oasis was followed by the announcement that he was the son of Zeus. Okay, Ziva is here. And finally, invoking the act of proskynesis as mandatory. There is a card for that, or. Meh. By using an entire action round to do so after he has become great king. Okay, this is it. The Persians can only win if the Macedonians fail a weariness check or if Alexander dies. For Alexander, it seems not so hard to find a strategy. I mean, he is simply militarily completely superior, and I guess he just rampages through Persia and, just tries to conquer it, and that's basically it. For the Persians, I really don't know what to do. The first time I tried it, it was a pretty frustrating and dull experience. An open battle against Alexander basically doesn't make a lot of sense. So I don't know what might make sense, and I'm not sure if this is really what historically happened is. Maybe to avoid too big losses and simply attack him again and again and again, because every time he has to fight, basically his war weariness goes up. But I think the army he has to fight must at least be half the size of his own army. So. But that is probably the way we want to handle that. We want to bring his war weariness up. Also, if he has to do a siege, his war weariness also goes up. So that might make sense. In addition, after every battle where Alexander is involved, he has to roll on an injury table, and there is a very good chance that his injuries go up a little bit. So I think it's this permanent attacking or this permanent delay of him which might in the end give the Persians a chance. Is that a lot of fun? I have no idea, but we will find out. So at the beginning, Alexander starts. So it's a chit pull system we have here. I don't know, about seven chits or something, maybe eight. I think half of them is for the Macedonians, the other half is for the Persians, and one is an administrative phase. Okay, so here we now have the sequence of play, and well, this APM activation, whatever marker, is not, that doesn't happen in the first turn, nor that replacement phase. So what we come right away to the player phase. Cards may not be played in the first turn. So we simply draw one of these cards. And, okay. Then we come to the activity segment, and we're basically, what you can do during this segment is you can simply move your troops, you can reorganize armies if they share the same space, you can, yeah, just move these strength points around, and you can move with your fleets. You can raise new armies and draw new leaders. And finally, you can declare this an administration phase. An administration phase basically allows you to replenish your treasuries and to remove your war fatigue markers from the armies. Okay, so Alexander will start and he will try to attack Memnon right away. He's not going to do this via a naval invasion, because that will give him some negative modifiers. So he moves here, one space, crosses the strait, that costs you two. So that is three spaces then. And then he tries an attack, that's the fourth space. Now, Alexander can move with his army four spaces. All the other armies can only move three spaces. There is a way to increase the range of the armies up to six, but you do this on risking the depletion of one of your treasuries. I wonder if Memnon should try to move back. He could try to avoid the battle at that point. And I think that makes sense. He's so weak. So, by the way, I want to leave. Ah, yeah, I forgot that. Right from the beginning, Alexander controls the European provinces, and, well, the Persians control, obviously, these Asian provinces with a red border. There are also frontier provinces. I think they are also controlled by the Persians, but there are some restrictions. I'm not absolutely sure about that. These are the ones with a white border, like this one. And also over here, by the way. Apart from that, you control a province if you are the only person who has any units in there. So I think at that point I want to leave a garrison here at Byzantium, and I can do this simply by moving through a space, and if I leave the space, I can simply place a garrison there. There is no cost, that I don't have to reduce my army or something. There is only a limited number of garrison markers there, so that is basically the only restriction. Then I want to place one here, so I control now also that region here, or that province, and now I can try to attack Memnon. Now he wants to avoid battle. He does this by rolling a die. The lower rating is the land battle rating, the upper one here, the one, is the naval combat rating. So we roll a die, add the result, add the battle rating to the die result, and if this is a 6, we can avoid the battle. And that's not the case. So right there we see the first battle of the game. And that's a relatively big one. So battling is pretty easy. Both players roll 2 dice. And we have a table here, the land battle table. And here on the top, we check how many combat units we have. So Alexander has 33. That means he rolls here on that column. And the other guy has 40, so he is one column on the right. But there are some modifiers. First, we can add the leader military capability, which is 2 in the case of Memnon and 4 in the case of Alexander. And then we can add the elite level superiority. The Macedonian army has an elite level of 4. The other guys only have an elite level of 1. That means we can add 3 in this case. So let's start for the attacker. And you see, this is a pretty ridiculous thing. I mean, we roll the 2 dice, and Alexander can add 4 plus 3 makes it 7. Okay. Okay, that is a 9. So right away we rolled a 16, which is actually the maximum possible result. And the other guys, they can add 2, and that's it. So they will definitely roll less. That is a 6. Okay, that's a 16 against a 6, which is a horrible result for the Persians right away. And that means, obviously, they lost the battle. Wait a minute, it's not that easy. We have a 16 plus, and they have 33. So it is actually, the battle rating is a 16. And the Persians have a battle rating of 7. Okay, so you can see here that's the die roll, and that's a 7, and here we have a 16 plus. So a 16 versus 7, and they have more than double the combat value, which gives them an additional bonus. Now, right now, that doesn't mean a thing. It just means they have lost the battle. It doesn't say anything about the losses. The loser has to retreat. So that means Alexander remains here now. Xisicus. And Memnon has to retreat. We have to roll how many spaces he has to retreat. And we can subtract the battle rating of the leader from the die roll. Okay, that's a 3 minus 2, so we have to retreat only 1 space, which is not too bad. We could retreat more than that. I'm not sure if I want to do this. So the thing is, I can retreat as far as I want to, but for each movement point, above why take additional losses. So that means if I'm forced to retreat because of my die roll, let's say 5 movement points, I take a lot more losses than I take now, where I only have to retreat 1 point. By the way, you can stop your retreat no matter what you roll, if you want to retreat into a city or into a stronghold. And I haven't explained that. This is a stronghold. It's the only one on the map. Okay, so I could now retreat into the city here, but first of all, that would give me an additional point. And by the way, the last step, the retreat into the city, doesn't count as a movement point for some reason. I'm not absolutely positive about that. Maybe I interpret the rules here in the wrong way, but that's how it seems, that's how it is at least worded. So if I would retreat now from here into the city, it would only cost me 1, 2 movement points for some reason. Anyway, I want to wait here. I don't see a big advantage to sit into the city. I might not have to fight an open battle there, but it doesn't really give you a big... a big battle bonus or something like some other games do. You simply will be besieged, and if you lose the siege or if the siege is successful, then all your troops are lost. So yeah, I don't want to sit in that city actually. Okay, now I had to retreat 1 space. Now I have to roll again for the losses. We start this time with the loser. We have here the attrition and battle loss table. And there are also some modifiers here. And let's see. I wonder. I thought there was... No, exactly. If Darius would have been present, we have to roll. He would have fled now because the battle result was more than twice as high as the ones of the Persians, the Macedonian battle result. But Darius is not there, so this has no consequence. So basically all that happens now is we simply have to roll a die. There will be no modifier, and we'll see how many people we lose. That's a 3. We have 40, so we have to check here and cross references with here. So we lose 4, which is not too bad actually. So we simply remove them here, replace that with a 4. Okay, and there we are. And now Alexander has to roll, and because he is the victor, he can... Ah, there we have it. -2 if battle score is less, twice that of the loser. Okay, so he can now subtract 2 of his die roll. So that is only a 1 in this case, which is here. And... he has, I think, 35 or something, so he will only lose 1 single point. Okay. Now, there is a rule. First of all, the loser of the battle will get a fatigue marker. And... we see that here. Fatigue marker is pretty bad because it kind of restricts you in your options and the things you can do, and it also gives you negative modifiers during battle. In addition, this army would be useless now because they took more than double the losses than the opponent's army. But that is kind of an optional rule. They suggest if you want a little more balanced game to not use that rule. And we have that, yeah, we got that here. While this mechanic reflects some of the realities of ancient warfare, it does help Alexander, something he doesn't really need. Those of you looking for a balanced game should consider not using the useless rule. Well, that's what I want to do. I'm not going to use it. Apart from the fact that the options of a useless army are even more restricted, if that army takes another defeat, it is completely wiped out, no matter how many units are in that army. And that is really tough, and I don't think I wanna see that. Okay, so this is now the end of the first battle. And it is possible that the elite level of the Macedonian forces goes up, but I'm not absolutely sure about that. And by the way, I miss a few additional tables here. It would be helpful to have them. For example, when this elite level rises. And yeah, if you win against an enemy with at least twice as big a battle score as the loser, then the elite level goes up. So now the elite level of the Macedonian force is at 5, and that is the maximum possible elite level for the Macedonians. The Persians have a maximum elite level of 3, but because they've lost a battle, they will lose one. So they're at 0 right now. Cannot go below 0. But that means now if we would see this another battle between the two armies, they could now add 5 to the die roll result. So it gets even harder for the Persians to somehow avoid a disaster. Finally, what we're going to do is, after every battle, let me check that again, there might be a special rule here. For each land battle involving a Macedonian army outside Europe against a Persian army of 10 or more ASPs, this war weariness goes up one level. Okay, that's the case here. And now, because Alexander was involved in that battle, we have to roll on the Alexander battle injury table. And that is a 10. That's not so great for Alexander. So he takes 2 injury points. So that might be actually worth it. So in the end, we might say, okay, that was actually a pretty good result for the Persians. Their losses weren't too bad, and Alexander took 2 hits here, so could have been worse. Okay, we're pretty much now at the end of that turn. Yep. And because it's pretty late and want to eat something before I go to bed, I'm gonna stop this video here, and I'm going to load this up, and hope to see you on the next one. Bye.